नमस्कार डॉक्टर एच.एस. बल्लाल जी, प्रो चांसलर, मणिपाल अकाडमी ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन, लेफ्टिनेंट जनरल एम.डी. वेंकटेश, वाइस चांसलर मणिपाल अकाडमी ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन, डॉक्टर पद्मा रानी, डायरेक्टर प्रोफेसर मणिपाल अकाडमी ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन, मणिपाल लुईस असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर द स्कूल ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन, मेंबर्स ऑफ द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, एकेडमिक कम्युनिटी, स्टूडेंट एंड फ्रेंड फ्रॉम द मीडिया, आई वॉज वेरी पर्टिकुलर टू विजिट द मणिपाल एंड विजिट यूर इंस्टीट्यूट. And then also deliver this endowment lecture. That's why we postponed it also. And even till 1 week back, I was keen to come. But my protocol people told me, so you have to wait for some more time. Had it been left to me as an individual, I would have come there. But you know, Vice President's office, institution carries certain protection. My dear brothers and sisters, I am very happy to be delivering this lecture. That too about a veteran general, great nationalist, the person who professed and practiced the value in public life. It is often said that we live in the information age. It's true, but it does not mean that earlier generations had nothing to do with information of any kind. In my view, life of all forms is driven by information in different degrees of awareness and consumption. Patterned migration of birds and animals prepared by information about availability of food, water, and congenial habits at different seasons of the year. Human beings, the most evolved with the most complex of biological architecture, with the passage of time and changing lifestyles, have come to demand and consume a wide variety of information. The rapid technological advances have widened the need for and diverse information from sources near and far. Thus, information has come to be the real power at present. Media has emerged as the main vehicle for delivery of such information. Hence, as a medium of empowerment, it became very popular and useful. In the process, media provides different perspectives and options. Sri Madhav Vittal Kamath was an iconic personality in the world of media for several decades, reporting and writing on a range of issues with analytical precision and offered a clear perspective on a range of complex issues from time to time. He left a distinct mark of his own during his long and illustrious career in journalism. Having born in September 1921, this is the centenary year of late Sri Kamath. I'm glad to have got this opportunity of speaking on journalism, past, present, and future in such a landmark year. Sri late Kamath ji chronicled the transformation of India with the lucid commentaries on a range of issues and events as the nation changed in varied ways. As a correspondent in leading capital of the world, Kamath ji earned the respect and goodwill of respective governments and the people, and he was an undeclared ambassador of our country. He kept reporting and commenting separate with objectivity distinguished his reporting with his own views, distinguished in his reporting and his own views. That is very much necessary. And perspectives reflected in his commentaries and columns. He made significant contribution to setting up of Prasara Bharati and to its functioning as its first chairman. Journalism, as we broadly agree, is the collection, preparation, and dissemination of information about current events and developments. Over the ages, the collection and dissemination of information has undergone remarkable transformation. I always say information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. We are now in the era for transformation, reforms, and now the need for correct information, accurate information, is more to take forward this reforms process. Returning merchants, mariners, and travelers were the first carriers of information from far-off places to homeland. Then came the handwritten sheets, pamphlets, and chronicles that were hung at important places. In my own village, town, of course, we used to read the newspaper written on the wall. It was called as Goda Patrika. Goda means wall. One freedom fighter, that era journalist, every day morning used to write on that. And we as youngsters used to go to that place in Nellore and read what was written on the wall. It was like a blackboard on the wall. Printing press brought the revolutionary change resulting in the emergence of newspapers in the 18th century, heralding mass communication. The print media continued its dominance into the 21st century despite the emergence of radio and television. There are millions still who like to wake up with a cup of coffee in a newspaper. I should admit that I am one among them, but without coffee. Because I don't have the habit of taking coffee and tea. With the emergence of a satellite communication and internet, the media scenario has now become topsy-turvy. 21st century is the era of internet. The last decade in particular has witnessed rapid expansion of internet, which has disrupted the traditional models of revenue and reporting. From the 24-hour cycle of the era of print, it is now instant generation. Speed of delivery of information is the essence, now presenting the journalism at crossroads. In the process, the line between the news and the fake news has become very thin and blurred. It is a matter of serious concern. This is the price of rapid technological changes and the growing thirst for instant information. As we seek to reflect on the evolution of journalism over the time and look into the future, I would like to share some of my broad concerns about journalism and the emerging media scenario. These include issues of freedom of press, censorship, norms of reporting, social responsibility on the part of media persons, decline in values and ethics of journalism, yellow journalism, sensationalization for profit reporting, opinionated reporting, disinformation in the form of paid and fake news, journalism of false crusades, disruption caused by the internet, and the future of media. These are some of the important issues that are agitating the minds of the people. As the newspapers were growing in number and strength since the 17th century, they were brought under censorship from time to time by rulers of the day, some sort of censorship. Napoleon clamped total censorship in the year 1800. James Augustus Hickey, who founded the first English newspaper in India, the Bombay Gazette in 1780, described it as a commercial paper open to all, but influenced by none. He thereby referred to the issue of freedom of press about 250 years ago. And this continues to be the matter of concern even now at various levels. This gadget also published a large number of advertisements, including import and sale of slave. It also carried gossip on the activities of the officials of the East India Company. Advertisements still matter, even now. More, of course, and gossip is one of the favorites that dance the media space. After the first battle of Indian independence in 1857, the colonial government came down heavily on the newspapers, and in particular against the vernacular press, as it was increasingly and assertively became nationalist. The Vernacular Press Act of 1878 gave extensive power of censorship to the authorities. In 1940, noted American journalist John Gunther wrote that only two of the 100 newspapers in leading European capital city were honest and columns were available for sale in other publications. Under communist regime, the media was required to promote the ruling ideology worldwide and publicize the stated goals of the country. In several non-communist developing countries, self-censorship and severe restrictions on the media are common. Yellow journalism seeks to cloud the facts by resorting to eye-catching headlines and promotes distortion and misinformation. Journalism based on taking up false crusades, as witnessed in the case of suicide of a film actor recently, is a fellow traveler. Both are aimed at increasing readership and viewership and should be avoided. Advertisement revenue is the key for the viability of any media organization. But with the mushrooming of media outlets and the shrinking revenue pie, the traditional norms and principles of journalism are being forced to be compromised with the serious consequences. The disruption caused by the technology has resulted in a serious flux, with media facing a serious crisis. Technology giants have emerged as the algorithmic gatekeepers of information, and the web has emerged as the main vehicle of distribution of information and news. We are witnessing the consequences. While the democratization and decentralization that followed the rapid expansion of social media, enabling freedom of expression, is welcome, the world is witnessing the downside of it, the absence of a self-regulation and protocol. In this era of saturated information and overabundance of news, the very news is getting devalued. While the traditional print media is sincerely enduring to adapt to the technological disruption by going online, is struggling to come out with the viable revenue models. Whatever may be online, but reading the newspaper directly, that enjoyment, that experience, you will not get. The information reports generated by the print media at substantial cost is being hijacked by the social media giants. This is unfair. Some countries are taking measures to ensure revenue sharing by the social media giants with the print media. We also need to take a serious look at this problem and come out with effective guidelines or laws by evolving a consensus to enable print media get their share from the huge revenues of the technology giants. Appropriate revenue sharing models need to be evolved for the survival of traditional media. There is a certain need to ensure sanity in the use of rapidly expanding social media, given the implications for social harmony, common good, peace and national security. Freedom of expression does not mean unfettered outbursts of anger and hate against each other that may lead to chaos. My dear brothers and sisters, the central job of journalism is to establish facts and share them as widely as possible so as to build a common base to debate harder questions that society faces over its values and its interests and who gets what share of the pie. It means to enable informed discussion on larger issues and giving voice to the voiceless. Mahatma Gandhiji looked upon journalism as a mean to serve the people. Politics, journalism, for such professions, they were initially started as a means to serve the people. That's why we used to call them as mission. But afterwards, we have seen at various levels the mission, which was a passion, has become for some people, commission, giving remission, doing omission, leaving the passion. That is an unfortunate thing happening at certain levels. This needs to be curbed. The newspaper is a great power, but just as an unchained torrent of water submerges oil countryside and devastates crops, even so the uncontrolled pen serves to destroy. This is what Mahatma Gandhi said. This is the foresight. Self-regulation is the best way to enhance the credibility of journalism. Discredited media is nobody's interest. The owners of media organizations, the editors, the journalists on the one hand, and the readers, listeners, and viewers on the other make the world of media. They're all human beings. They have their own predispositions. But the norm of objective journalism demand that personal views and position should not impact reporting of events. And viewers and readers too should not look for only such information, reports that suits them. The M.A. Kamath is known for maintaining that distinctness of views and reporting news. My distinguished friends, late Arun Jaitley, used to lament saying there are too many channels, but there is dearth of facts. This should change. A newspaper or any other media outlet should report the facts as news, present different perspectives on debatable issues besides conveying their own views appropriately. News, journal, views in the editorial or in the form of an article. News and views should never be mixed. Some people are doing it. The aim shall be to leave it to the reader or the viewer to take his own position without seeking to influence his mind. News and views should be strictly separate. One cannot masquerade as the other. Journalism by nature is supposed to be critical of the order of the times based on facts and supported by evidence. This should not slip into complete negativity. We are an independent country. We have to be positive. Positive, I am not talking of a COVID positive thing. Attitudinal approach. I am not suggesting that media is completely cynical. We have opted for parliamentary democracy for negotiated socio-economic transformation and national building. As a bridge between the people and the governments, media need to focus on the development taking place on various fronts. Governments are the principal catalyst of this change for the better. Development journalism does not mean beating the trumpet of the governments. It is about examining and reporting on the triggers of change, partnerships built and participation of the people and other stakeholders, challenges faces and the way they were overcome, etc. This kind of positivity reinforces the trust of the people in the institution of our body politic. Till the advent of modern media, print media played an important role in furthering the cause of independence by promoting the spirit of nationalism and nation building to socio-economic transformation subsequent. It is appropriate to reflect on the media scenario in our country at present. For doing so, it is imperative to understand the socio-political context in which the media is operating. To briefly recall this context, after about 35 years of political stability after independence, there was certain instability in between before stability was restored. These changes ran parallel to the changes in the perspectives and positions of the people, the passage of time. This transformation was founded on the way various issues and challenges have surfaced from time to time, the way they were articulated and dealt with by those in power. Media captured, reported, and commented on these changes widely, each giving their own version of commentary. Over a period of time, media in our country has acquired a certain orientation, which is broadly termed by the commentators as left-leaning and liberal. Nobody can make an issue out of it. That's their choice. But the problem arises if the media is keen to stick to the perspectives acquired earlier and stayed with them for long and refuses to acknowledge the changing narrative. I am not suggesting media to be like a traveler. Media should use a standard set of reporting and analytical tools that capture the change without imposing respective positions. Media should not be seen by public as discrediting the change, and that is happening since such a change is contrary to their long held positions. Our nation is committed to uphold the constitutional values of liberty, equality, fraternity, and justice for all. Whatever change is happening in our country over the last few years, it is within the framework of the Constitution. The task of nation building is still a work in progress, and this needs to be pursued with enhanced vigor and measured zeal correctly. Such a united effort calls for a strong sense of nationalism and national spirit that binds all Indians together. What is nationalism? Nation first, party next, self last. Any for any organization in that order. It is not correct to weaken the spirit by attributing the non-existing divisive perspectives. Media shall highlight with all the vigor the aberrations, if any, so that they are not allowed to reoccur. Presenting every incident or issue in a divisive perspective, looking it from a caste angle, or a communal angle, or regional angle, does immense harm to the goal of building a strong, resurgent, and developed India. Irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion, and religion, we are Indians. That should be kept in mind. Media in all its forms has immense ability to shape right public perceptions and perspectives as an effective tool of empowerment. It shall not become a part of the problem and instead be part of a solution. It is because, like every citizen, the government and other stakeholders, media too have a certain responsibility towards the nation. Media is facing a crisis situation by various reasons, including the technological disruption. The latest agenda journalism with its pitfalls is not in the interest of media and the society. The major challenge is to handle the information explosion and the attendant challenges to journalism in an effective and organized manner. Given the flux at the moment, I would not like to hazard a guess about the future of journalism. For a bright future, an auto correction is needed and perhaps inevitable. Effective and enabling working protocols is needed to ensure better future for media by addressing the challenges that are now staring at this important profession. Enabling regulations may be needed to be built in place. I am not in favor of self-restrictive regulation, and regulation should never become a strangulation. It should be self-evolved by the media. Journalism is a very demanding and challenging profession. With the evolution of media over the years, the present-day journalism demands a set of specialized skills. On account of its growing importance and rising recognition, a large number of youth, including those highly educated, are now taking to journalism. There is so much demand for the course of journalism. For making journalism more vibrant and rewarding, it is imperative to create an enabling environment, ensuring safety of journalists, proper skills and working conditions, including attractive remuneration. I pay my tribute to all those veteran journalists who have contributed to the growth of journalism in our country. I compliment all the working journalists for choosing journalism as a profession and serving the cause of empowerment of common man. We are required to interact virtually. The new reality forced us by the COVID-19 pandemic. Media is also hit badly by the pandemic. Not only managements, of course, journalists, workers, everybody is affected. Initially, there was a fear, but by reading newspaper, you will get infected by the virus. That's not correct. It has been proved beyond doubt. My dear friends, brothers and sisters, today, when we are talking about M.E. Kamaji, it is very important to understand his life, his conduct, the way he maintained professional values and set high standards in journalistic life. The younger generation, particularly the budding journalists, must read about the life of M.E. Kamaji and understand the role he played, the way he kept reporting and commenting separate, the objectivity distinguishing his reporting and his own views and perspectives. That is the speciality of M.E. Kamaji. Today, the trends that have crept in the media and the value system, ethics, which used to be in the forefront, certain erosion, and that too, the competition. And we rush for reporting. Sometimes efforts are made to sensationalize. Sensationalism means senselessness. You lose sense, no? When you sensationalize. So one has to keep in mind these issues and see to it that we get back to the value system, maintain standards, and then emulate the great examples set by the Kamaji and others. I'm very happy to be amidst you all today. Of course, I would have been much more happy had it been a physical intimate lecture rather than this online. You all know that being there in person, talking to people, greeting the people, interacting with the people, would have made a difference. That is actual. But today, because of the pandemic, we are forced to have this. I feel sorry for the same, and as requested, I will be definitely visiting Manipal Academy, this institution, taught by a great man, is doing great service to the field of education without compromising on academic standards and also maintaining the value certificate. Yeah. I'm told you have a beautiful campus and being a little away from the city and having all the nature's bounty, that's really a boon to the students. We need to have such institutions because of late we are seeing how the climate change is affecting our lives. We have to go back and see to it that we follow the age-old practice, which I say in my own way, the nature, culture, together for better future. That should be the line that has to be followed by one and all. I call upon the younger generation, student community, to follow discipline in their life, follow values and ethics, and also be friendly with the nature, do physical activity, because we have seen COVID effect. Whoever is physically fit, who has got a greater endurance, they were able to save themselves and also follow good food habits, because food also plays an important role in the children are how slowly adapting to sedentary way of life is not good. Less physical activity, that is also no good. Third, eating junk food. Junk food in the name of instant food. Instant food means constant disease. This has to be understood by all youngsters. We have wonderful, I am speaking about the campus in Karnataka, which is, and that too, this Andhra district, which is very famous for providing tasty, healthy food to the people. So I call upon the youngsters to understand the importance of physical fitness and also consuming healthy, proteinous food for your future, for the future of the nation. And I would like to thank the academy for inviting me to this function and providing me an opportunity to share my thoughts with the people. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.